Hello, Funk Academy! As I said, my name is Lauren Bullock. I'm a poet, I do spoken word, I perform. I'm also a teacher of youth. But tonight, I get to share this amazing stage with these fantastic performers! I do not have the body coordination it takes to do all that, so I'm always very impressed. I don't have a lot of time, so we're gonna get right into it. For those of you who have not been to a spoken word performance before, this is not just a monologue, right? This is just not me handing you my emotions, and you take them, and you're like, thanks, right? This is a conversation, right? A dialogue. So some of the ways that you can do that, if you're feeling a line, if it really resonates with you, yes, some of y'all already know, some of y'all are already veterans. You can snap. Can you snap for me? Yeah, ooh, sounds like some nice rain in here. It's okay if you can't. You can stamp, you can do what another poet, Jonathan Tucker, calls the chocolate yummy noise. It sounds like, can we do that on three? One, two, three, right? Oh, delicious art, give us more of it. And if you're an introvert like myself and you're like, I have a set amount of energy to give tonight and I was not planning on that, right? You can do what the DCU Slam team calls the awkward trick. And it looks like that. And I will know that you are feeling it. Cool. So hopefully by the end of this set, we'll be feeling like fam. But right now, I'm going to kick it off with an introductory poem so we can get to know each other. Cool. Y'all, growing up, I was a living slot machine. Like, if you guessed enough ethnicities correctly, it might mean you're a cultured human being, and yes, that means I like to be a smartass every time the Olympics are on and see how many countries I can claim before someone starts asking questions. On any given day, I can be described as red, yellow, tan, olive, heck, I'm probably more rainbow than a Lisa Frank art book on Pride Day, and at a fraction of my age, my little sister Alyssa already has some of the same problems. You see, my father tells me that the neighbors have asked about his Puerto Rican and Mexican daughters, and to be fair, Alyssa did go through a phase where she was obsessed with Dora the Explorer. But I think the neighbors just must not have looked at her soft smile. You see, Alyssa's joy is so inferno, she reminds you why they call us Blasians, diving headfirst into trouble like a phoenix bent on resurrection. I always thought this made her fearless, but I'm learning too often that light and light skin can be mistaken. My greatest fear is that Alyssa will learn to associate being darker with a shadow she can't grow out of. She's already embedded. She wished she looked like me, just a little lighter than the ashes, hair once straighter than feathers, but I can't explain to her how it feels when people assumed I straightened my hair as a denial of my heritage and not because there was no one there to teach me that natural is acceptable, that when even your black family has always been whites and black skin, you'll be told that barely escaping from the fire means you have no right to talk about heat or burns, and don't point to our former president as a sign of progress. I still pray that Alyssa is never Obama's into letting other people decide she isn't two sides of a coin that always lands face up. That when people ask her for ethnicity, then where she's from, then where she's really from, she will always remind them that there is no easy answer to their question, just an equation made of fractions. Y'all, sometimes having too many histories can be like having no history at all. I want to warn her not to be caught by the word exotic, that it just turns you to tropical fruit, a light-skinned berry with shallow roots, and us mulatto babies. Well, we get confused for confections often, so when they call you caramel, or mocha, or brown sugar, reply firmly that no, we are adobe-faced and dirt skin and earth people with a flavor-like foundation in the DNA of Eden. Baby sister, you are an ancient mosaic. Piece your skin into the question mark at the end of privilege, be the smudge across oppression, be permanent ink in a world where erasure sounds like she's not even full Asian or from there, as if we couldn't already relate just by being human. Remember, you are human. Hurt when someone else is denied equality on account of being too rainbow or too foreign for U.S. consumption or not the right religion. Share your fearless when they have none left, because mixed girl, we phoenixes, and we keep this world blazing. Yeah. participation. Raise your hands if you have ever been in love or had like a really deep crush. Right? Keep those hands raised if that was like a fantastic experience for you. 10 out of 10, we'll do again. Right? This next poem is not for the people with their hands raised. Shout out to my broken hearts in the building, I feel you. If my heart is poetry, then the last love poem I wrote is a crumpled up memo, and you are a journal I was hoping to fill my days with until the space ran out. But I must have cramped my writing hand because even muscle memory has forgotten how I used it. Were you thinking of her then too? When I flipped through your pages, did you remember her fingerprints on your surface edges? Was I just a creased corner pointing backwards to the place you saved for her? And when she broke your heart, did she also crack your spine so you would always fall in her direction? I admit, I never left you open on my nightstand, but I guess you were already stolen in someone else's secrets and affection, y'all. There's a reason I stopped using notebooks and pencils. At least the backspace is relatively painless when you enter into a document knowing it's only temporary. And no, I'm not afraid of her ink stains. Just my habit to Rorschach their meaning into tea leaf and palm line predictions, reminders that all stories must have endings, because I will always believe in the portent of disaster, even if it never begins. So when did I become so bold that I scrawled my thoughts in marker, hoping they would bleed through your body and become permanent? But you marked hers first. Said you would always be her diary, and I guess that just makes me another entry on an off day. But see, I don't care how many libraries there are in the world, I still look for you, but I can't find the right synonym for beautiful. When other people touch me, I'm searching for your plot lines. Your paper cuts are the first thing I was willing to plead for in so long. But I'm not blaming you, I'm blaming me. Because if my heart is poetry, then I only want you to remember the lines about love lingering like my scent on your t-shirt that night you asked me over. Even though we both had to get up early the next morning, do you remember? You said you put it on later just to be close to me again. But I'm not asking to be more than your friend, nor am I postponing an inevitable end. After all, they say, if you truly love someone, then let them go. So please know that I'm willing to paper crane all your pages until they papyrus the sky like the stars will finally discover when they turn out all the lights. And I may never be the one who sleeps next to you at night, but at least let me be the love letter tucked beneath your pillowcase to remind you that no matter what, you will always, always be worth the read, my love. Thank you.
Was a string of empty chrysalides, all my I love yous,
were hanging from someone else's butterfly bush. They had forgotten how to hover, how to slip from my lips and flit from face to face. Y'all, I tried to write myself a butterfly net, but my poetry is only a pushpin, and I am no entomologist. See, the last time I tried to dissect my feelings like this, I ended up with only broken wings and silence, and I'm sick of growing caterpillars in my capillaries for blooms that don't even belong to me, y'all. The truth is, sometimes I want to be a different garden with different secrets. Because this morning, when I woke up, my skin felt like wilt, like saltwater marsh. And I guess that's just the backlash from letting all this brackish build up in my tear ducts, y'all. My spirit has been a restless mockingbird since dawn, attacking its own reflection from instinct. I ask myself, whose song have I stolen this time? What caged bird have I borrowed from because my voice was not enough again? I am trying to learn heron for the moments I feel nestless, teaching myself to be all patience and stalk the depths for substance. But y'all, my wings were never built for flying, and I just don't stand that high, even on a good day. So forgive me when my spirit starts wandering to the tallest tree it can find and starts calling. I'm just searching for my own approval, reminding myself that weeds are just a part of the process, remembering to stop attacking apologies to my skin, because y'all, for somebody, my body is beautiful brown branches and deep roots, y'all. My darkness is just someone else's shade. So in the meantime, I will learn to love myself like I am growing monarchs, because this song is regal. This body is paradise. I am more than occupied space. I am an ecosystem thriving. Even when they say the category 5 is coming, let me be a shaking silhouette on the horizon. And in turn, I will learn to listen for every songbird's soul that doesn't know the lyrics. I will watch for every garden in the rubble, because we are still growing into our gorgeous. Our late blooms are still worth pressing like palms in prayer. And for every heart that woke up empty this morning, this poem is the last of my pushpins. But you, Funk Academy, you can have all of my butterflies. Y'all, thank you so much. You have been here.